December 1819, 1961.
Before, during, and after.
Memoir of the 20th Century Voyages by Dr. Fernando. The first book in a trilogy encompassed the period from his birth to the present day. And even earlier, as it uses glimpses of his ancestry, beginning with Antapo, originally from Udayana, who settled in the village of Rasol, four villages located in South Asia, and their subsequent conversion to Christianity, and the adoption of the surname Las after the Spanish missionary who baptized his ancestors. He touches upon historical facts which occurred in the 18th and 19th century, which cover aspects of the governance of the ex-Spanish Indian, including the turbulent period when the late Grand Member of Parliament, Bernard Cash de Silva, was deposed after being put in charge of his land by the King of Portugal, and the period following this revolt by a great section of the Goan army composed mainly of Luso descendants and Europeans, who were offended by the appointment of a local as the administrator of this colony. His youth was spent in Goa and in Bayer Mozambique, that Portuguese colony, where his parents and other siblings were living on account of his father's appointment in the British India Steam Navigation Company, to which place he was transferred, having first served in Mombasa and Dar es Salaam. Dr. Colaco did his preliminary studies in Beijing in the Museo Alfonso de Albuquerque in the complex of structures presently occupied by the High Court of Bombay and Goa, after which he studied law and obtained his licenciatura, law degree, at the University of Lisbon in July 1956. Soon thereafter, he was appointed as a substitute of the notary and as a government advocate on the picturesque island of São Jorge de Açores. Having been chosen after appearing in a competitive exam, he reminisces with great solidarity about the friendships that he built on that island, of the simplicity and friendliness of the islanders, of the protection and welcome that was extended to him. These are the memories that he carried with him. His next and perhaps welcome transfer was to Vila Velha do Rabo in continental Portugal, where he again encountered sympathy and good advice and built lasting friendships. Nostalgia drips from his pen. One can clearly feel that Dr. Colaco fell in love with the city of Lisbon, and this feeling comes across in his poignant recollections of the life that he lived in that city during his student days and thereafter. In the many friendships that he developed and nurtured, in his experiences, descriptions, and observations with regard to that city. His love for this land, however, was much greater than all the friendships and pools that exercised an influence over him in that metropolis. And when chance presented itself, he opted to work, perhaps throwing to the side the opportunity for a much brighter career in the pearl of the east of the Portuguese Empire. That he was appointed notary and assistant delegate. Dr. Colaco is truly a veteran, who, despite the fact of not owning any property in Goa, not even a house that he could call his own,
you can go that side,
came back to his motherland undaunted by the fact that his immediate family continued living in Paraguay, Mozambique, and that in Goa, he would have to build a new life and develop new friendships. His brief touches with regard to the forestry and the flora of Goa provides us with an idea of the great love that he bears for the land of his forefathers. He lived his patriotism and fought compared him to the person that has been his faithful companion all these years, his wife, Noronha. Together, they built a home and had two beautiful children, namely Adv Antonio and Fernando. His description of the operation codenamed Vijay, which heralded the annexation of Goa by India, and its consequences on his life and those of others, which occupies a substantial part of his earth, reflects an ambivalent state of mind. His narration of facts and the extracts of other reports on the surrender of the Portuguese defense forces, the role played by José Vieira Albernaz, the last Portuguese patriarch of Goa, and by the first and only Goan Secretary General, Dr. Abel Redouard, the Alvarez Pulas, in entreating the Governor General to surrender rather than fight, makes for an absorbing reading and is an eye opener. It is a testimonial to the fact that the last Portuguese governor, General Manuel Nova Salicino, if he had chosen, could have opted for a defense which would have safeguarded his honor at the cost of the destruction of parts of Goa with the resultant loss of civilian life. The humanity of the last Portuguese governor general comes across in stark contrast to the descriptions appearing in history books that the Portuguese armed forces surrounded out of the field. Goa holds a debt of gratitude to these personages whose deeds were kept out of the public domain and whose memory has been almost erased for reasons of political expediency. There are two other books written by Dr. Clark. The second is The Judiciary of Goa the Manuvi and the Case of Goa in December 1961. In the light of the Fourth Geneva Convention in 1949, civilian convention, which partly deals with the role played by the conquering Indian Army post 1961 with respect to the judiciary and part of the judiciary of Goa. As is well known, the Indian Army placed Goa under martial law and established a military government. During that period, and in total violation of the Fourth Geneva Convention, of which India was a signatory, it demanded a declaration of allegiance and fealty from the Goa judicial cadre, from the topmost chief justice of Ipoh, to Malabar South of Goa, Dr. Zer Ghani, whose mayor was here, to the junior most notary and delegate to the Republic, who happens to be the author of this trilogy. There were 25 individuals affected by this demand. On a personal note, four of them happened to be of my family. My father, Zer Ghani, his older brother, Guillermo, and my two first cousins, Luis Renato, Ibn Noronha, and Antonio Lobo. The angst that must have coursed through the opening of each of these individuals can be read between the lines, so also the anxiety and dread that afflicted them. Many having served in their office for the greater part of their lives, without being threatened, dismissed by the occupying power, unless they were removed or was the mothers of them. Seven of them eventually opted to leave Goa, but the majority stayed in the joint. Though it is not so stated in the book, many of those who stayed behind were made to suffer. By depriving them of the avenues of promotion for a long time. Dr. Ismael Vizier ultimately resigned and moved to Portugal, but his sufferings did not come to an end. This book narrates the vicissitudes of some of these personalities and contains some extracts of judgments and case studies and provisions of some of the applicable laws and things, which will be quite handy in any serious academic study of the period. The third book, titled The Return of the Gallows, Understanding the Death Penalty in Lower and Elsewhere, speaks of the capital punishment was abolished in Portugal in 1867, and it is probably slightly later, such as have been about. In Portugal, after a long and sometimes arduous battle by the abolitionists, prior to this, one can read in the narration of events that occurred in the wake of the deposition of the prefect, Governor Bernard Pérez de Silva, in 1835, and the bloodletting that came in its wake, including the murderous killing of the Lord Bathurst of the prefect. And the bloodletting that followed, including the murderous killing of the Lord Bathurst of the prefect, such as Marianne de Rocha and his companions, who surrendered to the army on being assured safe passage, as well as the savage punishment meted out to those involved earlier in the Beatles' conspiracy by the judiciary in the world, brings out starkly the small value that was placed on life at that time. And hence, the abolition of the death penalty in Portugal and colonies was a step in the right direction by the state. The author bemoans the fact that, through the extension of the Indian Penal Code, this barbaric punishment was brought back to the land that had been free of it for over a century. In his dissertation, Dr. Colaco takes us through the ever-evolving process, which ultimately resulted in the abolition of capital punishment in Europe. He quotes from the pioneering Italian criminologists, Cesare Bonesane Beccari, amongst others, who advocated this as early as 1764. He quotes extensively from the Indian judicial pronouncements of Justices Krishna Iyer and Bhattacharya to demonstrate that even in India, there is a strong current to do away with legal murder, quote unquote. Dr. Colaco's humaneness comes across in his intolerance for the taking away of life to this state. It is a cry against the punishment that involves killing. He argues that the value of life, however grievous the crime, far outweighs any offense, as it is based on the premise that a human being, with time, will repent and modify his or her behavior and be ready to join the mainstream of life. This book is not only topical, but is a must-read for those who, even in the present day, advocate the death penalty for rape, sexual offenses committed against women, rape, Nirbhaya, if you refer to Nirbhaya's incident, against children. Dr. Colaco is widely known in the profession of practice. In fact, on occasion, he was known to cite not only decisions which favored him, but also those that went against his case, leaving a new judge unfamiliar with Dr. Colaco, scratching his head in confusion as to for whom he was appearing. This trilogy is a case in point where one finds views which may seem contradictory, but which makes its reading interesting. It is written in a relaxed style, as if the author is having a fireplace chat with the reader. The books contain hundreds of valuable nuggets of information. His writing reminds me of a classical music composition with fumes and intermezzos that the author may seem to forget his narrative and in his digression, only to resume it a few pages or paragraphs later. I'm sure that this is an invaluable contribution to the history of Europe, which provides glimpses of the other point of view, which is sadly only too scarce amidst the prevailing journalism. My compliments and thanks go to the author for the great effort extended by him to bring out the truth